That going? Yep.
House will come to order. Members, please take your seats. Sergeant Arms.
The House is now in session. All persons not entitled to privileges on the floor, please retire to the gallery.
The members will rise and be led in prayer by the Reverend Calvin A. Duncan, pastor of the Faith and Family Church, Richmond, and remain standing to the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, led by the gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Let us pray. All wise and eternal God, we come to you today thanking you for your many blessings, thanking you for the very air that we breathe. We ask that you breathe on this meeting this morning. Grant us with your wisdom and words. Give all the participants in this meeting discernment and insight to handle the affairs of this great commonwealth. May our spirits be lifted with faith, hope, and love. And now unto you, who was able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The members will answer the roll call by indicating their presence on the electronic voting board. The clerk will close the roll.
Mr. Speaker, a quorum is present.
Pursuant to House Rule 3, I've examined and approved the Journal of the House of Delegates for March 7th, 2016. Motions and resolutions under Rule 39 are now in order. Does the clerk have any announcements or communications?
Yes, sir, Mr. Speaker. A communication from the Senate. The Senate has rejected the House amendments. Senate has rejected the House amendments to Senate Bill 440 and Senate Bill 625.
The gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Mr. Speaker, I move the House insist on its amendments and request the Committee of Conference on the previously reported legislation.
May favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Motion is agreed to.
In addition, communication from the Senate, the Senate has insisted on its amendments and requested a Committee of Conference on House Bill 895.
Gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Mr. Speaker, I move the House accede to the request of the Senate for a committee of conference on the previously reported legislation.
So may I favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. That motion is agreed to.
Finally, the Speaker appoints on behalf of the House Committee of Conference for Senate Bill 468, Delegates Ingram, Hugo, and Sproul. For Senate Bill 468, the Speaker appoints Delegates Ingram, Hugo, and Sproul, conferees and part of the House. Mr. Speaker, that completes the announcements I have at this time.
The gentleman from Henrico, Mr. Farrell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Rest for an introduction.
Gentleman may proceed.
Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen, we have hopefully joining us in the gallery, and if they are, please stand, and also in the viewing rooms, a number of students from Goochland High School and Randolph Elementary School. Joining them are their teachers, Ms. Jennifer Gates, Mrs. Yearout Patton. These students have taken a Capitol tour this morning and now enjoying visiting and watching session. I hope you will join me in giving the students and their teachers a warm House welcome.
We're pleased to have the students with us today and hope they enjoy their time in the Capitol. The gentlewoman from James City County, Ms. Pogge.
Thank you, Ms. Speaker. I rise for an announcement.
Gentlewoman has the floor.
Thank you, Ms. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, 2016 marks a special anniversary. In God We Trust, the official motto of the United States of America was adopted in a joint resolution by the 84th Congress and approved by President Dwight D. Eisenhower on July 30, 1956. In November of 2011, Congress passed House Resolution 13 by an overwhelming 396-9 vote, reaffirming our national motto and encouraging everyone to display it publicly. To celebrate the 60th anniversary of our national motto, the Congressional Prayer Caucus has initiated the Million Window Campaign, encouraging Americans everywhere to put it up. On behalf of the Congressional Prayer Caucus, I have with me these window clings with our national motto, In God We Trust, available for everyone who would like to put it up. Just see me, and I have these. They're a $5 value. Thank you.
The gentleman from Salem, Mr. Habib.
Ms. Speaker, I request permission to take the center aisle.
The gentleman may proceed.
Mr. Speaker, I ask the clerk to report a resolution.
Clerk will report a resolution.
House Resolution Number 24, commending Natalie DeFusco Funk, agreed to by the House on January 15, 2016.
The gentleman from
Salem. Mr. Speaker, members of the body, everybody in here knows that we have amazing world-class public education in Virginia. We're all very proud of our public schools and the teachers and the administrators that take part in those public schools. Every year we debate a lot of policy to improve our schools and advance our kids' education, but at the end of the day, we all know that no matter what we do in this body, the single most important thing in the growth of our children and our community's children is the teacher in the classroom with those kids. And we have some extraordinary teachers, and every year we get the honor of recognizing one teacher who doesn't come here on their own, but who comes representing all teachers, investing their lives in our kids. And that person is the Commonwealth's Teacher of the Year. Well, this year, Mr. Speaker, I'm especially honored to get to present to this body Mrs. Natalie DeFusco Funk. Mrs. DeFusco Funk is a fifth grade teacher at West Salem Elementary School. Besides having the great distinction of being the school where three little Habibs are educated every day, it's known throughout our region as a fantastic school. Ms. DeFusco Funk has not yet taught a Habib, which may be why she is still in the teaching profession. There is some concern about her future as the next two Habibs advance towards fifth grade, whether or not she will make it or not. But Mr. Speaker, joining Natalie today on the floor is her husband, Brandon. Where's Brandon? There he is. We also have the Superintendent of Public Instruction, Dr. Steve Staples, who everybody knows. We also have, Mr. Speaker, in the gallery with us, four of the other finalists. We have Lauren Osborne from Pocosin. We have Stacy Rice Lee from Northumberland, Kenneth White Jr. from Bedford, and Edward McCann from Appomattox. And Mr. Speaker, it truly is these teachers representing teachers statewide. They've done extraordinary things and have been recognized for that, but they're here carrying the banner for all those teachers who toil every day in our classrooms, loving our kids and teaching our kids. But today's especially about Natalie from Salem, so I'm going to tell you a little bit about her. Natalie was born in Rhode Island. Whatever.
Tennessee.
Oh, excuse me. She grew up in Rhode Island. Apparently that's a state. She was born in Tennessee, which she apparently thinks is better because she just mentioned that to me, but whatever. She earned both her bachelor's and master's degree from Boston College's Lynch School of Education. She was inspired by her fifth grade teacher to become a teacher. She knew that's what she wanted to do. So after graduating, she taught in another state up in the Northeast. And then in 2010, she and Brandon moved to Virginia, starting in Botetourt, and ultimately ended up in Salem, where she teaches now. There's a long list of things Natalie does, both in the classroom and outside the classroom, to improve our community. But again, like all of our teachers, she's invested 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 12 months a year, making our communities a better place. A lot of people in this body have gotten to know the superintendent of Salem Schools, Alan Siebert, over the last few years through some of the work he's done. Dr. Siebert is very proud to represent and to speak highly of Natalie, and told me that he views Natalie as a lifelong learner and natural leader. She's an exceptional teacher, consummate professional, who positively changes the lives of young people and facilitates the growth and development of not just kids, but her colleagues as well. So, Mr. Speaker, today we are honored to have both four of the finalists for Teacher of the Year and our Teacher of the Year, Natalie DeFusco-Funk, here representing teachers across the Commonwealth. I understand her sub plans today included the link to watch this video online. So in just a second, I hope we will all cheer extra loud so that the kids watching back at West Salem Elementary will know how proud we are of Natalie DeFusco-Funk. So, Ms. Speaker, today I'd like to honor Natalie DeFusco-Funk, the 2015 Virginia Teacher of the Year.
We are very honored to have you with us today and your colleagues with us as well. We congratulate each one of you for your accomplishments. Everyone in this room can remember at least one or two teachers that meant something special to them as they were gone. Mr. Habib was in the third grade for 4 years. He really came to know his fourth grade teacher. But we thank you all for coming, and we appreciate so much what each of you do and all of your colleagues. Thank you for being here today, and congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Speaker.
The gentlewoman from Richmond City, Ms. Carr.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I ask for a point of personal privilege.
Gentlewoman has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, in this month, as we salute women's history, I'd like to recognize today Adele Goodman Clark, a founding member of the Equal Suffrage League of Virginia and a founder of the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts. Born in 1882 in Montgomery, Alabama, Adele spent her early childhood living in various southern states from Mississippi to Virginia. Settling in Richmond in 1894, Adele enrolled in Virginia Randolph Ellett School, now known as St. Catherine's School. Upon graduation with an interest in art, Adele received a scholarship to the Chase School of Art in New York, now known as Parsons School of Design, where she studied with renowned American artist William Merritt Chase and Robert Henry. Returning to Richmond, Adele, along with Nora Houston, established a studio that became a training ground for a generation of Virginia artists. Adele's work, an oil painting called Cherry Tree, is in the Virginia Museum of Art's permanent collection and is viewable now hanging near the McLaughlin collection. Adele applied her sharp intellect, artistic skills, and determination to champion women in the arts. Around 1909, her interest in the women's suffrage movement began to flourish. She began to meet with other civic-minded women to establish a statewide suffrage organization. Many women wanted to vote in order to work more effectively for the passage of health, education, and child labor laws. Upon being elected recording secretary of the Equal Suffrage League of Virginia, Adele recruited her mother and sister, helped direct legislative initiatives, designed postcards, organized rallies, and went on speaking tours that helped establish chapters throughout the state. Adele sometimes set up her easel in public places, such as around Capitol Square, and began drawing chalk sketches in order to lure people to hear her expound on the importance of women's suffrage. Despite the fact that the Equal Suffrage League of Virginia was one of the most vital suffrage organizations in the South, the General Assembly defeated women's suffrage resolutions in 1912, 1914, and 1916. Virginia suffragists, therefore, directed their work primarily toward the passage of an amendment to the U.S. Constitution. By the time Congress submitted the 19th Amendment to the states in June 1919, the Virginia League boasted 30,000 members. Adele chaired the Virginia Ratification Committee in 1919 and 1920. Nevertheless, Virginia was one of the 9 southern states that refused to approve the amendment. It was 1952 when finally the Commonwealth did ratify the 19th Amendment. Within a few weeks of the national ratification of the 19th Amendment in 1920, the Equal Suffrage League disbanded, and its successor, the Virginia League of Women Voters, began to work to make the new vote an informed one. Adele chaired the organization committee to establish the league and served as president intermittently from 1921 to 1944, serving in various capacities on the local, state, and federal levels. Adele continued to advocate for social issues, the arts, and government efficiency. She was active in the Richmond community for decades. Converting to Catholicism in 1942, her mother had been Jewish and her father raised in the Church of England in his native Ireland, she helped organize the Richmond Diocesan Council of Catholic Women and shaped its legislative program. She was instrumental in establishing Virginia's Art Commission. In the early 1970s, I had the privilege of meeting Ms. Clark at the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts when she visited the Lone-owned art gallery in Robinson House, where I worked. After a long and prosperous life, Adele died in Richmond at the age of 101 and was buried in Emmanuel Episcopal Church Cemetery in Henrico County. Adele is one of 12 women whose bronze image will be featured in the Virginia Women's Monument planned for Capitol Square. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentlewoman from Chesterfield, Ms. Robinson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise for the purpose of an introduction.
Gentleman has floor.
This morning's prayer was offered by Calvin Anthony Duncan, pastor and founder of the Faith and Family Church in Chesterfield. Pastor Duncan's life was struck by adversity at birth with his mother's untimely death and no knowledge of who his father was. He was reared by his aunt in Linden, New Jersey, and never allowed the circumstances of life to deter him from the plan that God had for him. Basketball was his instrument out of the urban community that led him to Richmond. He attended VCU on a scholarship and earned a degree in criminal justice. In 1985, he was commissioned by his church in Virginia to preach the gospel. Pastor Duncan was drafted by the NBA. However, he opted to play with Athletes in Action, a Christian organization. He traveled overseas, playing and coaching in the CBA. Calvin mentored groups of men, married couples, and spearheaded a reading program to over 40 schools in Washington State. He conducted chapel services, Bible studies, and missions in Mexico and Canada. After returning to Richmond in May 1997, Pastor Duncan was appointed to the position of youth and assistant pastor in the city. He also began a youth center, aiding children in 5 area schools with an after-school program. Pastor Duncan indicates that each experience in his life, from growing up in Linden, New Jersey, to his basketball career, to being a youth pastor, led to his role as leader of Faith and Family Church, which began in June 2004. Under Pastor Duncan's leadership of being open, transparent, and accessible, the membership continues to rise. He and his wife, Barbara, have 4 children, Richard, Shannon, Chelsea, and Azelle, and I ask the House to extend a warm House welcome.
The gentlewoman from Westmoreland, Ms. Ranson.
Mr. Speaker, I rise for a request.
Well, may state it.
I'd like to request the journal reflect that my seatmate, the gentleman from Halifax, is away due to pressing personal business.
The only one out.
The gentleman from Fairfax, Mr. Keem.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise for an introduction, please.
The gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, joining us in the gallery today is a very special guest, and I'd like to ask for the body to spend just a couple minutes with me and knowing the significance of this visit. In the gallery today, and I'd ask you to stand, is Michelle Lee. She is the Undersecretary of Commerce for Intellectual Property and also the Director of the United States Patent and Trademark Office. And for those of you who are not familiar with the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, it's a government agency which is very unique in that it's one of the very few government agencies that does not take taxpayer funding. It actually generates its fees from use in the private sector for the innovation industry and the economy that's growing using our intellectual property. And of course, the Patent and Trademark Office is headquartered in Virginia, in the Commonwealth. When it was founded in the 1700s, it was President George Washington who signed the first Patent Act into law, which created this office, and one of the very first directors of the Patent and Trademark Office, or the predecessor of it, was Thomas Jefferson. So Virginia's had a long history of supporting innovation and patent and trademark and other intellectual property. And today, the head of that office is Michelle Lee, who is not only the first woman to head up that office in the 225-year history of the agency, but she's also the first Asian American. She's here today to celebrate International Women's Day. Along with the governor, she launched the Million Women Mentors Program in Virginia, in an event just across the street from here, to encourage a million men and women to mentor young women to go into the STEM field, which is, of course, the innovation and the industries of the future. And so she's here to promote innovation right here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. She's also a resident of Virginia living in Falls Church. She comes to us to Virginia from the great state of California, where she has spent many years as both a computer scientist and engineer, as well as an attorney, working for Google and many other high technology industries. So we couldn't have a better, more finer, more qualified person to head up our United States government's agency that deals with innovation and technology. And so I'd ask that the House to give Michelle Lee a warm round of applause.
We're delighted to have you visit with us today, and we hope you enjoy your time here in the Capitol. The gentleman from Fairfax, Mr. Albo.
Speaker, have an introduction, please.
Gentleman has the floor.
Speaker, members of the House, a couple times in recent years I've mentioned the magic of this place is that we are citizen legislators. And that's why we get bills passed, we get balanced budgets, because we all have real lives, but we don't know everything. And in this business of passing laws in Virginia, we rely on a wide variety of people. We rely on our clerk staff to keep the show running. We also rely on government affairs professionals to kind of tell us what they know about certain things, because I only know a little bit about the law. Most of us here would all admit we don't know everything, except for the gentleman from Salem. But other than that, all of us know we don't know everything. And I wanted to identify one of our friends from the government affairs professional community, lobbyist community, is Mr. Denny Gallagher, who is up in the audience today, or in the gallery. Denny, from my calculation, has been working with the General Assembly since the late 70s, probably about 40 years. Started at the Department of Corrections. He worked with the home builders, of course, the beer wholesalers. Denny has worked with, we calculated, five different speakers, 10 different governors, and from my calculation, well over 1,000 different delegates and senators. And Denny is finishing his career. This is his last session. And I just wanted to thank you for a great years of service and your professionalism. Thank you very much.
I apologize for that outburst. The gentleman from Hopewell, Mr. Ingram.
Mr. Speaker, I rise for a motion.
You may state it.
Mr. Speaker, I would move that on page 5, Senate Bill 767 go by for the day.
Without objection, Senate Bill 767 by for the day. The gentleman from Virginia Beach, Mr. Mayorkas.
Mr. Speaker, I rise for an introduction.
Gentleman has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, joining us today in the gallery is Diane Smith and Tara Chang from Operation Turbo, if they wouldn't mind standing. They represent, in many ways, the best Virginia tradition of service above self. Diane Smith is the founder and CEO of Operation Turbo, which is determined to send our brave soldiers overseas both a box of different treats from home, but also, more importantly, a personal note of gratitude. She started Operation Turbo. The inspiration was visiting her niece an officer on the destroyer USS Stout. And while she was there, while her niece recognized and was so thankful for her help in giving her care packages, her niece noted to her how heartbreaking it was, the number of fellow sailors on her ship that received nothing. And at that point, in that great Virginia tradition of deciding that she saw a need and was going to stand in the gap, she started Operation Turbo, and they've already, since 2014, sent over 1,000 different care packages all across, not only to our men and women in the Navy, but to our Marines, our special operators. And so, Mr. Speaker, when we have so many soldiers overseas that they miss baseball games, they miss birthdays, they miss those quiet moments with their families that each one of us cherish, and too often, they are out of sight, and for too many Americans, they're out of mind. And so I'm so thankful for people like Diane Smith and Operation Turbo that recognizes that and wants to send them a thank you. So please, for the House, if you're interested, OperationTurbo.org is a website, but please give a very warm welcome to Ms. Diane Smith and Tara Chang from Operation Turbo.
Pleased to have the visitors with us today, and we thank you for all that you do for our servicemen and women. Gentleman from Culpeper, Mr. Freitas.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise for a point of personal privilege.
Gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Today we'll be voting on House Joint Resolution 409, which is a commending resolution for Sergeant First Class Charles Martland, who I had mentioned a couple weeks ago. I just want to say, first of all, thank you very much on behalf of myself, behalf of Sergeant First Class Martland, for the overwhelming support and the co-patronage that we've had for this resolution on both sides of the aisle and in both houses. I just want to speak very briefly on why I think this particular resolution is so important. Obviously, there's been a lot of behind-the-scenes work, a lot of behind-the-scenes advocacy on his behalf in order to try to convince the military to allow Sergeant First Class Martland to continue serving. But that's not why we did this resolution. This commending resolution, in my opinion, is more for the family. And that's because Sergeant First Class Martland has a wife and two small boys. And I will guarantee you that after three combat tours and multiple other tours, there have been more than one occasion where Mrs. Martland has had pulled those two boys in when it was either something good happening or they were afraid or waking up from a nightmare, whatever it may be, and had to pull them in and say, Daddy loves you, Daddy misses you, he wishes he was here, but his country needs him. And I can tell you again from personal experience that coming back, how important that is, the important role that your spouse plays in ensuring that your kids still recognize you and know you when you come home. But I will guarantee you that has been beat in over and over and over again. Your daddy loves you. He misses you. He wishes he was here. His country needs him. And the reason why it's so important that we pass this, and it's so important that everyone that hasn't had an opportunity to sign that would like to take that opportunity, is because at some point, his boys are going to have to ask the question. That is, if this administration cannot be prevailed upon, if the Army cannot be prevailed upon, his boys are going to ask him the question, why doesn't the country want you anymore? And in that instance, he could sit down and he could say, because when I was overseas, I saw a little boy that was being harmed. And in that moment, I didn't just see a little boy, I saw my own son. I saw someone like you. Because there was an instance where a woman was being beaten. And in that instance, I didn't just see a woman, I also saw someone like your mother. And so I acted. And for that, the country doesn't want me anymore. He could say that to his boys, and we will have earned the entire contempt within the statement if we don't come to support him now. What I want to do is I want to provide him an opportunity that if his boys should ask him that question, he can look at this committing resolution with the overwhelming support of this body and say, no, not that the country didn't leave me, not everybody. That within the jurisdiction where this body holds sway, they held not only my service, but the entire service of our family in high regard. And that is why, if you haven't had an opportunity to sign this to us, I would encourage you to do so. For all those who have signed, I greatly appreciate it. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
The gentlewoman from Newport News, Ms. Price.
Mr. Speaker, I rise for an introduction, a request, and a motion.
Gentlewoman has the floor.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, today we have with us the Virginia Peninsula Food Bank, if they will stand, including CEO Karen Joyner. The Virginia Peninsula Food Bank is a treasure located in Hampton, Virginia, and was established in 1986. Being more than just a food pantry, they run programs like the Agency Distribution Program, the Backpack Program, the Culinary Training Program, and the Share Program, just to name a few. They serve 74,000 food insecure individuals across the greater Virginia Peninsula, and while doing so have earned a 4-star rating from Charity Navigator for 10 consecutive years for their financial efficiency, effectiveness, accountability, and transparency. They have distributed more than 164 million pounds of food, which equals 137 million meals. And this year, ladies and gentlemen, the Virginia Peninsula Food Bank will celebrate its 30th anniversary of providing food assistance, nutrition, and education to the 9 cities and counties it serves. On behalf of Delegates Helsel, Hodges, Mason, Morris, Pogge, Tyler, Ward, Yancey, and myself, we ask that you please give them a warm house welcome and thank them for their vital work.
We're honored to have the members from the Virginia Peninsula Food Bank, and we thank you for all that you do for the Commonwealth.
Mr. Speaker, I request that House Resolution 204 on page 42 be called out of order.
The clerk will report a resolution.
House Resolution number 204, commending the Virginia Peninsula Food Bank.
Mr. Speaker, I move the adoption of the resolution.
As many as favor that motion will please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. That motion is agreed to.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The gentleman from Bedford, Ms. Byron.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise for a point of personal privilege.
Gentlewoman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen in the House, quite a few of you have come up to me asking me what happened to the COPN bill that was progressing through both bodies. And I just want to stand for a brief moment and tell you what happened to that. As many of you may already be aware, yesterday the other chamber referred House Bill 350, legislation to initiate reforming COPN, to the Senate Finance Committee. That bill will be carried over to the next session. I want to thank leadership, members of the body for engaging in this discussion, and many, many hours spent in both chambers to draft bills that would offer and make long overdue changes to the outdated COPN law. Your interest indicates to me that this is something that you were considering very seriously as well. This year, for the first time since Virginia enacted this law, legislation to reform this burdensome regulatory structure advanced further than it has ever before, indicating that there's consensus on reform. We simply ran out of legislative time. We're now poised to go much further. Delegate O'Bannon's House Bill 193, along with its companion Senate Bill 561, will be studied by the Senate Education and Health Committee and readied for next session in January. My House Bill 350 is now in the Senate Finance Committee and will also be considered in the months to come. What did we learn from tackling this issue? We learned that if we want to alleviate spiraling health care costs for our constituents, we must end state-sanctioned monopolies that stifle innovation and competition. If we don't end these regional monopolies, we can, like our counterparts in Maryland, our neighbor to the north, treat these monopolies like we do utilities and give the State Corporation Commission the responsibility of overseeing and regulating their pricing and controls. Finally, we learned one thing for certain, Mr. Speaker. The status quo cannot stand. We owe it to the people that we serve to address the issue of limited choices, spiraling expenses, and stifled innovation. So we will be back next year. I wanted to let you be aware of that so you can go home and talk to the real consumers of health care and get their opinion on this very important legislation and let you to know we'll be back even stronger next year. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman from Shenandoah, Mr. Gilbert.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise for a request and a motion.
The gentleman has the floor.
I would request that Senate Bill 750 on page 2 be moved to the regular calendar for the purpose of an amendment. And a motion, Mr. Speaker.
Without objection, Senate Bill 750, the regular calendar. Yes, sir.
Mr. Speaker, I would move that the following bills go by for the day. On page 1 of the printed calendar, Senate Bill 9. On page 2, Senate Bill 750. On page 3, Senate Bills 669, 578, and 579. On page 4, Senate Bills 758 and 41. On page 5, House Bill 773. Page 11, House Bill 883. We remain adamant that Senate Bill 767 on page 5 go by for the day. Also, Mr. Speaker, House Joint Resolution 446 on page 18, would ask that that go by for the day as well.
Thank you. Without objection, those bills and House resolution will go by for the day. The gentleman from Fairfax, Ms. Watts.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise for a point of personal privilege.
The gentlewoman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. With all those bills going by for the day, I think we have a little bit of time for me to share some free to share some free advice with you that is worth, of course, what you pay for it. But there's absolutely nothing political about what I'm about to share, but I just could not resist the urge to try to be helpful. So, ladies and gentlemen of the House, it is tax time. And it's my sincere hope that some of you, maybe even many of you, will find some benefit in what I'm about to share, based on my having recently come out clean as a whistle from an IRS audit of my legislative business expenses. The only problem was convincing the IRS that you and I pay taxes on our office expense reimbursement. Ever since I entered the House, I've followed the best I could the Virginia Society of CPAs booklet provided to us each year, A Legislator's Guide to Tax Policy, or excuse me, A Legislator's Tax Guide. I remember the first time I looked through it, how surprised I was at what's regarded as a legitimate business expense in fulfilling our role as a legislator. As you know, we get $1,250 each month to cover such expenses. Let me say again what I said in the beginning. Taxes are withheld from this monthly payment because if it isn't spent on expenses related to serving your constituents or to fulfilling your role as a legislator, it is taxable income. To the degree, however, that you choose to keep track of your legislative expenses, most, if not all, can be claimed as an employee business expense and therefore a tax deduction. In my case, every year, for a long time, my deductions for out-of-session and legislative expenses always have exceeded the $15,000 before tax amount we receive to pay for those expenses. The result of taking these deductions is about a $4,000 federal tax savings at our family's income level. However, to retrieve the taxes you've paid on this non-accountable office expenses reimbursement, you must be prepared to do three things. One, you and your aide must make a relatively small effort to keep your receipts. Here is my basic folder. This has all for the year. This is it. We just chuck them in as they come along. in documents, we just throw everything in it. It documents those frequent outlays for paper, toner, stamps, notebooks, parking fees, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Two, you must have your calendar set up in such a way that it can be saved so you will have proof of your activities, especially your out-of-session mileage, which for me is over 5,000 miles a year, and I have a very small district. The calendar setup that I use is an Excel spreadsheet, which works well to schedule everything in because you can just put as much as you need in each of the rows, as well as for totaling things up at tax time. Three, it will take 4 to 6 hours each year to organize those records, including computing your mileage to places you normally don't go, which I do using Google Maps. You or your tax preparer will then fill out a Form 2106, which looks like this. But of course, I fill it out on TurboTax. Everything I just said was going to be covered as part of a seminar session for members after crossover, but unfortunately, the best person from the Virginia Society of CPAs for such a seminar was not available before we adjourn, but she promises to help conduct such a session sometime next January before tax season rush for those CPAs. And I understand also that the clerk's office will be following up my remarks with some additional information. But meanwhile, freshmen, start keeping your records. And next January, you'll get a walkthrough on what is appropriate to deduct and be able to ask your questions then. For the rest of us, may I share my perspective? One, first, everything we touch can be placed in one or more of four buckets: personal, campaign, legislative, and/or what must be reported on our financial disclosure statement. There are gray areas between all of these. It's not always a slam dunk decision. My gut check has always been to take 10 steps back if I feel I'm even close to the line. I offer that rule of thumb to you as a way to survive an audit when the size of our routine employee business expenses doesn't match the normal IRS profile. Two, the Virginia Society of CPAs tax guide is your most basic defense that you've acted in good faith based on what it contains. Three, I would recommend an 80-20 rule for expenditures made outside of active campaigning that might have campaign benefit. We run every 2 years, and 20% of 2 years is almost 5 months. So I split the annual fees I pay, 80-20, between a legislative expense and a campaign expense for things like my bulk mail permit, web hosting, computer security, and voter files, as well as the cost of a new printer or computer. My newsletter is nonpartisan, but any that I send outside my district, I treat as a campaign expense. As far as supplies used during an actual campaign, I find it easier to just treat all purchases during that time period as campaign expenses rather than have to prorate them. Four, as far as the split between the rest of my life and my legislative life, again, I recommend staying well back from the line. My legislative office is in my home, but there's no way I would want to take on the IRS challenge of claiming a home office. Therefore, my $15,000 plus per year in legislative expenses does not include rent and utilities. However, I do apportion phone and internet access. Obviously, each of our office setups are different. Well, that's enough for now. Bottom line, you may thank me, but then again, may not. Anyway, whether you keep track of it or not, the bulk of the $15,000 you receive for legislative district expenses will, in fact, be needed to serve your constituents and to be an accessible and informed legislator, just in case the press ever asks you. You can choose to pay $4,000 additional in taxes. A decision, I believe me, I would fully understand if you don't have the time or the focus for the basic elements I've just outlined. This is true whether you prepare your own taxes or whether you just sign your tax preparer's paperwork based on your input and receipts. Whatever you do, heads up. Or as the sergeant used to say on Hill Street Blues, be careful out there.
The gentleman from Fairfax, Mr. Hugo.
Mr. Speaker, I rise for an introduction.
Are they still here?
They just got here.
Gentlemen, may proceed.
Mr. Speaker, I hope Angeles Academy and the gallery would rise. Angeles Academy, my kids used to go to one of the great little schools in Northern Virginia, providing a great quality education, Catholic education, to so many young men and women. Today, they're led by Ms. Osella, who brought them down here. I hope we give them a warm, warm house welcome.
We're delighted to have the students with us, and I know you enjoyed this spellbinding discourse we just went through. Gentleman of Suffolk, Mr. Jones.
Speaker, I'll rise for a request.
Let me say it.
Can we have 1,000 copies of the speech printed by Director Park, please?
The gentleman from Suffolk, Mr. Jones, asked for 1,000 copies of the speech. As many as favor the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, now. Are there further motions or resolutions under Rule 39? If not, the clerk will call the count.
Calendar for the Virginia House of Delegates for today, Tuesday, March 8th, 2016. First category is a bill, Senate bills on third reading uncontested calendar. Senate bills, third reading uncontested. Page 1 of the printed calendar, Senate Bill 9 has been taken by for the day. Turning to page 2 of the printed calendar, Senate Bill 57, a bill to amend and reenact a section of the code relating to a number of district court judges. The bill was reported to the Committee for Courts of Justice with an amendment.
The gentleman from Fairfax, Mr. Albo.
Mr. Speaker, members of the House, let me explain these amendments. These, we did the caseload analysis for judges a couple years ago to find a better system to calculate how many judges each area needs. And the system was implemented, and then I think it was 2 years ago, we asked the state courts to go back using that system to see what the effect of interpreters would be, and I think there was maybe an underestimation of travel time for judges. The study came back, and these two circuits, one's Fairfax Juvenile, and one is Augusta General District. And so the study says that these judges are needed. Now, here's where the politics comes in, because if we were to authorize these, then we create a bigger fight on the budget. And so most likely these would not even be funded anyways because the implied need's not high enough. So our solution is to ask that you pass this with these committee amendments, and the committee amendments make these judge seats effective in 2018, which takes it out of this biennial budget. For us in Fairfax, it's not optimum because we'd like to have them funded now, but, you know, politics is the art of the possible. So I'd hope that you would adopt the committee amendments.
The question on adoption of the committee amendment. As many as favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The amendment's agreed to.
And Senate Bill 750 has been moved to the regular calendar and taken by for the day.
Shall the block vote pass? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 97, noes 1.
Ayes 97, noes 1. The bill is passed.
Continuing with today's calendar, Senate bills on third reading regular calendar, next category. Senate bills third reading regular. Senate on page 3 of the printed calendar, Senate Bill 669, Senate Bill 578, Senate Bill 579, and Senate Bill 758 have all been taken by for the day. So the first bill, third reading regular, is Senate Bill 204, a bill to amend and reenact several sections of the code relating to real estate settlement agents. Bill passed the Committee on General Laws.
The gentleman from Hanover, Mr. Peace.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, Senate Bill 204 adds new closing disclosure language as required to be used for most closed-end consumer mortgage transactions by the Federal Regulatory Agency, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. It also proposes a definition for closing disclosure. I want to thank the gentleman from Falls Church for scrubbing the bill over the last couple of days. I move that the bill pass.
Shall the bill pass? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 97, no 0.
Ayes 97, no 0. The bill is passed.
Senate Bill 41 has been taken by for the day. Page 5 of the printed calendar. Next bill, Senate Bill 446, a bill to provide for the submission to the voters of a proposed amendment to the Constitution of Virginia, adding to Article 1 a section numbered 11A relating to the right to work. The bill is reported to the Committee on Privileges and Elections.
The gentleman from Spotsylvania, Mr. Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, Senate Bill 446 is the bill, the enabling bill that puts the constitutional amendment for putting the right to work in the Constitution on the ballot for the voters to decide this November, and I move that it pass.
Gentleman Charlottesville, Mr. Toscano.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Speaking to the bill.
Gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, it's almost April, and every April, there's a little golf tournament played down in Augusta, Georgia called the Masters. And you probably are already seeing the advertisements for the Masters with a very famous quote by Jim Nance, a tradition unlike any other. So we're talking about the constitutional amendment. I'm talking about Jim Nance and tradition. And the reason I'm talking about tradition, ladies and gentlemen of the House, is that we have a tradition in this body that seems to occur every year. And that tradition usually involves a bill targeted to organize labor for a problem that doesn't exist. This is one of those bills. Before I get to the reason why we shouldn't vote for this because it's a problem that doesn't exist, I want you to remember a little bit about the history of organized labor in this country. The labor movement in this country transformed America, largely for the good. It was organized labor that built the ships and the aircraft that went overseas to help us win that war. They built the skyscrapers, and they even put the elevators in it, the boilers in the basement, the electricity in it, in the plumbing in those buildings. They helped build the railroads, the great interstate highway system, roads and bridges that we travel on and get our goods to market. They helped build the hot lanes in Northern Virginia, the Woodrow Wilson Bridge, phase one to Dulles, on budget and on time. They changed America. They were the coal miners that mined the coal that fueled the industrial renaissance of America. And while they were doing that, they were also changing things in a social way. The 40-hour work week, thank you, organized labor. Old age pensions, relief for the destitute, prohibitions against child labor, safer workplaces, wages by which people could pay to buy a home, to buy a car, to put their kids through school. These are very tangible benefits that sometimes we forget about when we talk about these bills on the floor, but we shouldn't forget about them. Now, Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, the captains of industry fought against a lot of these changes that we now take for granted. We should not lose track of that as we think about this bill. Now, we talked about this a couple weeks ago and talked about the fact that there is no threat to right to work in Virginia. None. No court cases, no legislation, nothing. Right to work has been on the books in Virginia for over 50 years, and there's never been a serious challenge to it. So what are we doing here? We are trying to score some really nice political points by putting something on the ballot. And in the process, we are proposing to change our Constitution, not something to be taken lightly. So, Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, I hope that you will vote today not to mess with our Constitution, not to put things in our Constitution that we already have in law that nobody's threatening. I hope that you will vote no on this constitutional amendment. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman from Stanton, Mr. Bell.
Speaking to the bill.
The gentleman has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, in response to the gentleman, I would say this. If organized labor today was what organized labor was in 1930, then this would be different, and we wouldn't need this bill. But we all know that it's not. We watched decades of politicizing in organized labor. We've watched decades of corruption manifest itself, and we don't need that. And it's not our Constitution, if you're talking about just the people in this body. The Constitution belongs to all the people, just like the government does. And what this bill does is allow those people to decide whether they want this to be a permanent part of the Virginia Constitution. And that's where the decision should be made, and that's what this bill allows to happen. So I would encourage you to pass the bill.
The gentleman from Suffolk, Mr. Morris.
Mr. Speaker, speaking to the bill. The
gentleman has the floor.
Ladies and gentlemen, right to work is not about right to work is about not being forced to join a union. Right to work does not disestablish any union. It simply says that it dissolves the servitude that you're bound to these unions to provide your hard-earned money to an organization you may not even believe in. The right to work is a freedom to work and to keep your hard-earned money as you see it and not be forced to join these organizations. Hope we pass this bill. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Shall the bill pass? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 65, noes 34.
Ayes 65, noes 34. The bill is passed.
Senate Bill 767 has been taken by for the day. Senate Bill 750 has been moved to the regular calendar and is by for the day. Continuing with the calendar, next category, House Bills with Senate Amendments, page 5 of the printed calendar. House Bill 773 has been taken by for the day. First up, House Bill then accordingly. House Bill 476, a bill to amend and reenact two sections of the code relating to requiring submission of animal intake policy. The bill passed the House January 26, passed Senate with a substitute on March 3rd.
The gentleman from Campbell, Mr. Ferris.
Yes, sir. Mr. Speaker, my House Bill 476 left the House on January the 26th with a 98-0 vote. But as one of my many mentors here would say, on the way to the Senate, it caught a fever. It had a little physical impact of $56,000 to add one line item on the application to the state veterinarian's office. So what the Senate did was they put an amendment on it that said that you didn't
put it on, you didn't put your intake policy on your application. You just mailed a copy of it in to the state veterinarian. I hope it'll be the pleasure of the body to accept the Senate amendments.
Shall the Senate amendment be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 74, noes 25.
Ayes 74, noes 25. The Senate amendment is agreed to.
Turning to page 6, printed calendar, House Bill 46, a bill to amend the Code of Virginia relating to the establishment of the School Readiness Committee. The bill passed the House February 15th, passed the Senate with a substitute on March 4th.
The gentleman from Loudoun, Mr. Greeson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, this bill passed out on the 15th from the House. It went over the Senate. They have an interesting concept about where a report should go regarding the work done by the School Readiness Committee. I think that concept needs a little bit more work. So we are going to, I'd like to ask you to reject the Senate amendments.
Shall the Senate amendment be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 0, noes 99.
Ayes 0, noes 99. Senate amendment is rejected.
House Bill 98, a bill to authorize the issuance of special license plates to immediate family members of a member of the Armed Forces of the United States who lost his or her life on or after March 29, 1973, while serving on active duty or while assigned to an Army Reserve or Army National Guard unit in a drill status. The bill passed the House February 16th, passed the Senate with a substitute, which was subsequently amended with amendments on March 4th.
The gentleman from Spotsylvania, Mr. Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, the Senate amendments simply open it up to members of any military reserve component or National Guard component. The way it was drafted, it would only have applied to Army Reserve and Army National Guard. Now, if we adopt the Senate amendments, it will apply to any reserve or National Guard. I move that we accept the Senate amendment.
Shall the Senate substitute with amendments be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 99, no 0.
Ayes 99, no 0. The Senate amendment to the substitute are agreed to.
House Bill 381, a bill to amend and reenact a section of the Code of Virginia relating to children with disabilities, alternative means to demonstrate achievement of the standards of learning. Bill passed the House originally on February 15th, passed Senate with a substitute on March 4th.
The gentleman from Loudoun, Mr. Greeson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, this bill deals with alternative means for the SOL test with regard to children with disabilities. The Senate wanted to make sure that we are not saying it's an easier test. We're not trying to reduce the rigor for which we expect the children to perform, but if there's a requirement to change the means or the way we deliver the test based on their disability, that's what we're trying to accomplish. That's what the Senate substitute does, and I would ask the House to accept the Senate substitute.
Shall the Senate substitute be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 99, no 0.
Ayes 99, no 0. Senate amendments are agreed to.
Continuing with page 7, today's printed calendar, House Bill 407, a bill to amend and reenact a section of the code relating to designation of HOV lanes on Interstate 66. The bill passed the House February 16th, passed the Senate with a substitute on March 4th.
The gentleman from Fairfax, Mr. Bulova.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, the purpose behind House Bill 407 was to make sure that HOV on I-66 wasn't prematurely switched from HOV-2 to HOV-3. Simply for the purpose of tolling. What the Senate amendment does is delay the implementation of the bill until 2017 so that it doesn't conflict with the bond issuance process for I-66 outside the Beltway. The net effect is exactly the same, and so I'd ask that the body accept the Senate substitute.
Shall the Senate substitute be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, no 0.
Ayes 98, no 0. The Senate substitute is agreed to.
House Bill 730, a bill to amend and reenact section of the code relating to commuter parking lot signs in Planning District 8. The bill passed the House February 16th, passed the Senate with a substitute on March 4th.
Gentleman from Fairfax, Mr. Lamontagne.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, this is the bill that says if you want to park in a commuter parking lot in the morning in Northern Virginia, then you've got to be taking Metro, a bus, or a carpool. And the Senate said that you could park and ride a bicycle. That's fine with me and good exercise, too. So I hope it'd be the pleasure of the body to adopt the Senate amendment.
Shall the Senate amendment be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 96, noes 3.
Ayes 96, noes 3. The Senate amendment is agreed to.
Continuing with the calendar, House Bill 894, a bill to amend and reenact a section of the Code of Virginia relating to the Standards of Learning Innovation Committee membership emergency. The bill passed the House February 1st, passed the Senate with a substitute on March 4th.
The gentleman from Loudoun, Mr. Greeson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In the spirit of the last two bills that we just talked about, the Senate had an additional great idea on one of my bills to talk about the reporting structure for this SOL Innovation Committee. They thought it was a great idea. I didn't think it was a great idea, so I'm going to ask that we reject the Senate substitute. Thank you.
Shall the Senate substitute be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 1, noes 98.
Ayes 1, noes 98. The Senate substitute is rejected.
House Bill 939, a bill to amend and reenact a section of the code relating to auxiliary lights on motorcycles and autocycles. The bill passed the House February 9th, passed the Senate with a substitute on March 4th.
The gentleman from Rockingham, Mr. Will.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, there's light at the end of the tunnel. I appreciate everyone's support through the process on auxiliary motorcycle lighting, and in the Senate, at the late hour, there was finally a compromised reach. The state police determined that they could indeed develop some standards to approve auxiliary lighting, and so that's the substitute that we have before us. And as we speak, there's already a working group that's going to begin to work with the state police in developing those standards. And so, again, I want to thank everyone for standing strong for motorcycle safety, and I move the Senate amendment or the substitute pass.
Shall the Senate substitute be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, no 0.
Ayes 98, no 0. The Senate substitute is agreed to.
Turning to page 8 of today's printed calendar, continuing with House bills, Senate amendments, House Bill 961, a bill to amend the Code of Virginia relating to alternative tuition or fee structures. The bill passed the House originally February 15th, passed Senate with a substitute on March 4th.
The gentleman from Montgomery, Mr. Rush.
Mr. Speaker, could I go by temporarily to find a prop? I withdraw.
I don't think you need one.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, House Bill 961 wanted to provide flexibility to universities and students to provide alternative tuition program. The Senate bill or Senate substitute actually improves on that, and I would move that we accept the Senate substitute.
Shall the Senate substitute be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, no 0.
Ayes 98, no 0. The Senate substitute is agreed to.
House Bill 1114, a bill to amend and reenact several sections of the Code of Virginia, as well as a part of the Acts of Assembly of 1960, which provided a charter for the City of Colonial Heights relating to Department of Finance, Director of Finance, City Manager, and City Treasurer. The bill passed the House February 16th, passed Senate with an amendment, with amendments on March 4th.
The gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hope it would be the pleasure of the House to accept the Senate amendments. This is the charter change for Colonial Heights that shifts local tax collection functions to the Director of Finance. The elected treasurer will keep the state revenue functions. Most of these amendments are technical. There's one that has a little bit of substance. It came from the Treasurers Association. It says the City Council may authorize the treasurer to assume such duties of the Director of Finance as the council deems appropriate. In other words, if they want to go back, let the treasurer do that. They can do that by ordinance instead of having to come back here for another charter change. So with that, Mr. Speaker, I hope I will accept the Senate amendments.
Shall the Senate amendments be agreed to? The clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 99, no 0.
Ayes 99, no 0. The Senate amendments are agreed to.
Turning to page 9 of the printed calendar, House Bill 8, a bill to amend and reenact various sections of the code relating to the creation of the Virginia Virtual School. The bill passed the House February 16th, passed the Senate with amendments March 7th.
The gentleman from Stanton, Mr. Bell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, House Bill 8 is the reenactment of a bill last year that also passed both houses and was signed by the governor with a reenactment clause. We have brought the bill back. It has passed the House again this year, passed the Senate. The Senate attached some amendments to it, not all of which are bad and could be negotiable in a conference, I think. Some are probably not negotiable. So I would ask the body to reject the Senate amendments.
Shall the Senate amendments be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 3, noes 94.
3, noes 94. The Senate amendments are rejected.
Turning to page 10 of the printed calendar, continuing House bills with Senate amendments, House Bill 180, a bill to amend and reenact a section of the code relating to drug treatment court for the city of Winchester and counties of Clark, Frederick, and Warren. Bill passed the House February 16th, passed Senate with amendments on March 7th.
The gentleman from Frederick, Mr. Collins.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, House Bill 180 lies similar to House Bill 8 in that the Senate made some amendments to it. Some are good, and some of it cut sideways to some other agreements that were made. And therefore, working it out in conference would probably be in the best interest. And I was told to, okay, thank you. I ask that you reject these amendments.
Shall the Senate amendments be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 0, noes 98.
Ayes 0, noes 98. Senate amendments are rejected.
Turning to page 11 of the calendar, printed version. Continuing, House Bill 389, a bill to amend the Code of Virginia relating to parental choice education savings accounts. The bill passed the House February 16th, passed the Senate with amendments on March 7th.
The gentleman from Loudoun, Mr. LaRock.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the two amendments modify this bill by one, providing some clarifying language in the First Amendment from the Finance Committee, and second, they add a reenactment clause to the bill, and I move that we accept the amendments.
Shall the Senate amendments be agreed to? The clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 52, noes 47.
Ayes 52, noes 47. The Senate amendments are agreed to.
And House Bill 815, a bill to amend and reenact section of the Code of Virginia relating to the method of execution. Bill passed the House February 10th, passed the Senate with an amendment yesterday.
The gentleman from Manassas, Mr. Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would move this. This really is unnecessary language and creates some vagary in the bill, and I move that we reject the Senate amendment.
Shall the Senate amendments be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 0, noes 99.
Ayes 0, noes 99. Senate amendments are rejected.
And House Bill 883 has been taken by for the day.
Mr. Speaker.
Yeah, gentleman from Arlington, Mr. Lopez.
Having voted on the prevailing side of HB 8 on page 9, I'd like to move that we take a revote on that. I'm not re. Reconsider the vote. Thank you very much.
The gentleman from Arlington, Mr. Lopez, having voted on the prevailing side, by which we approved, do we approve or rejected the Senate amendments, we reconsider that vote. As many as favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The motion is agreed to. Shall the Senate amendments be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 0, noes 97.
Ayes 0, noes 97. The amendments are rejected.
Turn to. Continuing with the calendar, page 12 of the printed version, next category of bills, resolutions, regular calendar.
Speaker.
The gentleman of Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Mr. Speaker, I'm going to move the House stand in recess until 12:45.
The gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox, moves the House stand in recess until 12:45. As many as favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no.
No.
That motion is agreed to.
The House Republican Caucus will meet immediately upon a recess downstairs in House Room 1. That is the only caucus that will be meeting presently.
The House stands in recess until 12:45. House will come to order. Members, please take your seats. Sergeant Arms. If the gentleman could get out of the way.
Mr. Speaker, a message from the Senate.
The gentleman from Rockingham.
Mr. Speaker, I've been directed by the President of the Senate to inform the House delegates the Senate has agreed to House Joint Resolution 424.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The House will come to order. Clerk will continue with the calendar.
Continuing with today's calendar, page 12 of the printed version, next category, resolutions regular. Page 12, resolutions regular calendar. First up, Senate Joint Resolution 70, proposing an amendment to the Constitution of Virginia by adding in Article 1 a section numbered 11A relating to the right to work. The bill is reported for the Committee on Privileges and Elections.
The gentleman from Spotsylvania, Mr. Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Senate Joint Resolution 70 is the actual proposed amendment to the Constitution to place the right to work in the Constitution, and I would move its adoption.
Shall the resolution be adopted? The clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 64, noes 34.
Ayes 64, noes 34. The resolution is adopted.
Senate Joint Resolution 127, submitting to the voters a proposed amendment to the Constitution of Virginia in conformity with the provisions of Section 1 of Article 12 of the Constitution of Virginia. Report to the Committee on Privileges and Elections.
The gentleman from Spotsylvania, Mr. Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Senate Joint Resolution 127 does what the earlier Senate bill did, and that is it puts the proposed right-to-work constitutional amendment on the ballot for Virginians to decide this November. There were concerns given the governor's position on the amendment that the bill may get vetoed and then there would not be a mechanism to actually place the amendment on the ballot. So this is being done through a resolution rather than a bill. I move its adoption.
Shall the resolution be adopted? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 64, noes 34.
Ayes 64, noes 34. The resolution is adopted.
Continuing resolutions regular calendar, Senate Joint Resolution 157, confirming appointments by the governor of certain persons communicated January 26, 2016. Resolution was reported for the Committee on Privileges and Elections.
Gentleman Spotsylvania, Mr. Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This resolution simply confirms appointments made by the governor, and I would move its adoption.
Shall the resolution be adopted? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 97, noes 0.
Ayes 97, noes 0. The resolution is adopted.
Turning to page 13 of the calendar, Senate Joint Resolution 158, confirming appointments by the governor of certain persons, communicated February 9th, 2016. Report for the Committee on Privileges and Elections.
General Spotsylvania, Mr. Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Senate Joint Resolution 158 confirms appointments made by the governor, and I move its adoption.
Shall the resolution be adopted? The clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, noes 0.
Ayes 98, noes 0. The resolution is adopted.
Senate Joint Resolution 182, confirming appointments by the governor of certain persons communicated February 23rd, 2016. Report for the Committee on Privileges and Elections.
The gentleman from Spotsylvania, Mr. Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is the final appointments resolution by the governor, and I move its adoption.
Shall the resolution be adopted? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 97, no 0.
Ayes 97, no 0. The resolution is adopted.
Continuing with the calendar, memorial resolutions laid on the speaker's table. The memorial resolutions begin on page 13 of the printed calendar. The memorial resolutions to be adopted in block are listed on pages 13 through 15 of today's printed calendar.
Does any member desire to remove a resolution from the block? Hearing none, all those in favor of adopting en bloc the memorial resolutions laid on the speaker's table as listed on pages 13 through 15 of the calendar shall please rise. The resolutions are agreed to.
Continuing with the calendar, next category, commending resolutions laid on the speaker's table. The commending resolutions to be adopted in block are listed on pages 16 through 20, with the exception of House Joint Resolution 446.
Does any member desire to remove a resolution from the block? All those in favor of adopting the commending resolutions laid on the speaker's table on pages 16 through 20 of the calendar, with the exception of which one was it? House Joint Resolution 446 and House Resolution 204, will please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed will say no. Resolutions are agreed to.
Continuing with the calendar, on page 20, next category, House bills vetoed by the governor. Page 20, House bills vetoed by the governor. House Bill 259 is an act to prohibit the Board of Education from replacing the standards of learning with Common Core state standards without prior statutory approval. The bill originally passed the House January 27th. The governor's veto is before the body.
The gentleman from Loudoun, Mr. LaRocque.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the bill before us was very easy for us to come to agreement on when it was originally voted on, because it is a very, very simple bill. The question this bill addresses is, should we leave the decision of whether or not Virginia would follow 45 other states and opt into the Common Core, leaving that decision up to an unelected body of 9 people on the Virginia Board of Education? The decision to opt in would be a major shift in education policy, and it would be one which would carry significant costs to implement. It should be made by this legislature. The governor apparently is not a fan of Common Core. He referred to it as a step backwards, and I agree. The governor reminded us, and I quote the governor, in June of 2010, the Board of Education echoed this sentiment by unanimously adopting a statement in support of the standards of learning and voicing opposition to the Common Core state standards, end quote. Yes, the board in 2010 opposed Common Core. And that puts it to rest, right? Well, it actually does not. I'd like to point out that the current board is not the same board that made this resolution. There's one remaining member. Mr. Speaker, we have a saying around my house. I, being the head of the household, make all the important decisions. But my wife knows that she has the responsibility of deciding what's important. Mr. Speaker, the question we have before us is, who gets to make this very important decision, a decision to opt into a major shift in education policy, one that could cost literally billions to implement? It seems pretty obvious the answer is that we should make that decision. I'll close by saying that if we fail to take ownership of this decision, an unelected board may make it for us. If there is no plan to adopt Common Core in Virginia, there should be no problem voting yes on this bill. Please vote yes on House Bill 259 and put this issue to rest. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman Fairfax, Mr. Simon.
Mr. Speaker, members of the House, I rise to speak to the veto.
Gentleman has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, members of the House, I understand what's happening here. You all don't like Common Core. We don't like Common Core. The governor doesn't like Common Core, and we have no plans to implement Common Core. It's not going to happen. So this bill does absolutely nothing, and that's the problem. The bill does nothing except say that for this one particular policy, we want the State Board of Education to come to us before they could possibly think about doing it. Nobody's thinking about doing it. The bill doesn't do anything. It's unnecessary. The governor doesn't think it's necessary. We don't think it's necessary. I would encourage the body to sustain the governor's veto. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, a message from the Senate.
Gentleman from Rockingham.
Mr. Speaker, I've been directed by the President of the Senate to inform the House delegates that in the execution of the joint order pursuant to House Joint Resolution 424, a nomination has been made by the Senate for certain judicial office as listed in the attached papers.
Thank you.
He just hates it. Can you, what did they do?
I think LaRock might be an unelected figurehead of this.
House will come to order. Gentleman from Augusta, Mr. Landis.
Mr. Speaker, speaking to the governor's veto.
Gentleman has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, as a leader of the House, I think we've lost the purpose of this legislation, and I want to redirect you to why we do need this legislation, and more importantly, why we need to override the governor's veto. It's very great that the governor agrees that Common Core is not good policy for Virginia, but Governor McAuliffe will not always be governor. He will eventually leave office, and if we want to take a position of setting in the code why we think Common Core is not appropriate, and more importantly, not leave that responsibility or that authority to the Board of Education, we will override the governor's veto. We've done this before in the past, and more importantly, the Board of Education does a good job, but they do not set the education policy for the Commonwealth of Virginia. The General Assembly does that. And this is a policy matter. Whether you agree or don't agree whether Common Core is appropriate policy for the Commonwealth of Virginia, I would remind members, especially on this side of the aisle, that No Child Left Behind was a policy that we did not think was appropriate for Virginia, but was forced on Virginia by a Republican governor, a Republican president. And just as No Child Left Behind directed from the federal level what we should do from an education standpoint in Virginia, Common Core does the same. In a different manner, in a different way, but it's still having the federal government determine what the policy for public education would be in Virginia. So I hope you will vote yes to override the governor's veto, because it is our decision, and more importantly, should not be given and allowed to be given to the Board of Education alone to make that decision. It is our decision. So let's support overriding the governor's veto and make sure that Virginia's policy is one of not agreeing to Common Core.
Just to be clear, the gentleman from Loudoun, Mr. LaRocque, wishes for the House to override the governor's veto. Shall the House override the governor's veto? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 64, noes 32. Yes, sir.
The bill.
Mr. Speaker.
Gentleman from Shenandoah.
You have not announced the vote yet, is that correct?
That is correct.
So is the vote still open?
The vote is, no.
Where, Mr. Speaker, parliamentary inquiry.
Gentleman, state it.
Where are we procedurally then if the vote has not been announced, but the chair says that the vote is closed?
I've closed the roll. I have not announced the vote. So that's where we are procedurally.
Further parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Speaker?
Don't state it.
If a member was not in his seat and wished to vote at this point, would it be possible to do that? All right.
Yeah, just destroy the roll and we'll take it over.
Mr. Speaker, parliamentary inquiry.
Gentlemen, state it.
Has not the vote been taken and the roll closed and the vote is closed unless there's a proper motion to reconsider the vote before the body?
You haven't announced.
It's pretty clear that the roll was closed and you were ready to announce the vote. I don't think there's any doubt the roll was closed.
I haven't announced the
has not the roll been closed? Okay.
Yes. Been closed.
I'll announce it. The vote was 64-32. It failed. Yeah.
Continuing with the calendar, the next category, we have several conference reports
Speaker.
That have been submitted.
The gentleman from Colonial Heights, Ms. Cox.
Parliamentary inquiry.
Yes, sir.
I don't think we heard, did the motion pass or fail?
It failed.
Okay, I thought it was two-thirds of those present.
It is.
Two-thirds of 99.
99.
8, okay.
Present.
99.
How many members?
99 that answered the roll call.
Yes, who answered the roll call? No.
No.
Clerk will continue with the calendar.
A conference report has been received for House Bill 127 on page 21 of today's calendar. Is also available online in IHOD on LIS as well. The conference report for House Bill 127, a bill to amend and reenact a section of the code relating to real property tax exemption, spouse of member of armed forces killed in action.
The gentleman from Virginia Beach, Mr. Knight.
Mr. Speaker, this is the language that we think is the most clarifying, and we have the conference report signed, so I move the adoption of the conference report.
Okay, you might want to tell people what it did.
Yes, sir. This is the Killed in Action bill, and what it does is the original language is for tax relief in here, and it was it said Killed in Action includes a determination by the United States Department of Defense of died of wounds received in action. We thought that was more clarifying than the original language, so that's what's going to be in the bill.
Thank you. Shall the conference report be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, no 0.
Ayes 98, no 0. The conference report is agreed to.
Turning to page 22 of today's printed calendar, a conference report has been received for House Bill 148. Conference report for House Bill 148 on page 22 of today's printed calendar. House Bill 148 is a bill to amend and reenact a section of the code relating to real property tax assessment, date to fix the tax rate.
The gentleman from Hanover, Mr. Fowler.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, the original House version set the date to fix the rate at May 30th. The Senate version decided on April 30th. So we basically split the difference, and the conference report fixes the rate at May the 15th. I hope it be the pleasure of the House to adopt the conference report.
Shall the conference report be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 99, no 0.
Ayes 99, no 0. The conference report is agreed to.
Continuing on page 22 of today's printed calendar, a conference report has been received for House Bill 386. House Bill 386, a conference report, is a bill to amend and reenact a section of the code related to certified nurse aides, training on observational and reporting techniques. The conference report is before the body.
The gentleman from Loudoun, Mr. Minshew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The version of this bill that passed the House had the verbiage in there, including but not limited to. The Senate struck that verbiage without telling us exactly why they chose to do so, and worried about the law of unintended consequences, we rejected that Senate amendment. Mr. Speaker, I learned something that during conference, there's a code section on point. I'm not making this up. Title 1-218 that says, whenever the word includes is used, it means includes but not limited to. I learn something every day, Mr. Speaker, and with that bit of education, I would move that the conference committee report be accepted, which accepts the Senate amendment.
Shall the conference report be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, no 0.
Ayes 98, no 0. The conference report is agreed to.
Another conference report has been received also on page 22. Conference report of the printed calendar, House Bill 646. House Bill 646 is a bill to amend and reenact section of the code related to the Department of Behavioral Health and Developmental Services related to substance abuse. Report on state plan for substance abuse services. Conference report is before the body.
The gentleman from Petersburg, Ms. Aird.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the conference report for House Bill 646 simply clarifies language as to who receives the substance abuse report and when, and I would hope it would be the pleasure of the body to accept the conference, adopt the conference report.
Shall the conference report be agreed to? The clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, no 0.
Ayes 98, no 0. The conference report is agreed to.
Turning to page 23 of today's printed calendar, conference report is received for House Joint Resolution 69. House Joint Resolution 69, establishing a joint subcommittee to study the use of driver's license suspension as a collection method for unpaid court fines and costs. Report. Conference report is available online and before the body.
The gentleman from Richmond City, Mr. LaPosse.
Yes, sir. This is year number two of this particular House joint resolution. And we got to this place last year at this time, and we had a disagreement about how many senators and how many delegates would be on this particular commission. And the majority leader has worked all of this out, and we have reached an agreement with the Senate to have three senators and four delegates on the commission. So that's pretty good. So I'm asking you to accept the conference report and pass the House joint resolution.
Shall the conference report be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 98, noes 1.
Ayes 98, noes 1. The conference report is agreed to.
Turning to page 24 of today's printed calendar, conference report is received for House Joint Resolution 84.
The gentleman from Virginia Beach, Mr. Stolle.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Joint Resolution 84 continues the work of the subcommittee on recurrent flooding. We had similar issues with the numbers of senators and delegates that was resolved by Delegate Cox. Mr. Speaker, I move to adopt the conference report.
Shall the conference report be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 99, noes 0.
Ayes 99, noes 0. The conference report is agreed to.
And Mr. Speaker, turning ahead to page 27 of the printed calendar. Page 27, a conference report has been received for Senate Bill 445, a bill to amend and reenact section of the code relating to real property tax assessment take to fixed tax rate. Conference report is available online before the body.
The gentleman from Hanover, Mr. Fowler.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, this is the same situation that we found ourselves with respect to House Bill 148. Mr. Speaker, I move adoption of the conference report.
Shall the conference report be agreed to? Clerk will close the roll.
Ayes 99, noes 0.
Ayes 99, noes 0. The conference report is agreed to.
Mr. Speaker, that completes today's calendar.
The House is returned to the morning hour. The gentleman from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Speaker.
Gentlemen, may state it.
Mr. Speaker, I would ask that since the House has returned to the morning hour, is it now proper to renew the provisions of the Joint Order Resolution HJR 424?
I would say to the gentleman, this is the appropriate time as we have returned to the morning hour pursuant to House Rule 39. And the morning hour is the time for the House consideration of motions and resolutions and to dispatch the business on the Speaker's table. Therefore, the House is now in the posture to proceed with the election of the Supreme Court Justice pursuant to House Joint Resolution 424. Mm-hmm. House will be at ease. House will come to order. Members, please take your seats. Nominations are now in order for Justice of the Supreme Court of Virginia. The clerk will report a resolution.
House Resolution 213, nominating a person to be elected as a justice of the Supreme Court of Virginia. Resolved by the House of Delegates that the following person is hereby nominated to be elected as a justice of the Supreme Court of Virginia as follows. The Honorable Rossi D. Alston, Jr. of Manassas, as a justice of the Supreme Court of Virginia for a term of 12 years commencing March 3rd, 2016.
The gentleman from Charlottesville, Mr. Toscano, speaking to...
Yes, speaking to the resolution.
Come on, the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House. The other day, I rose to contest whether the special order, at least as I described it, was properly before the House because it did not receive a two-thirds vote. I'd like to state again, for the record, my concerns about going forward with this resolution, because if the joint order, the joint and special order, was not properly before the House, there's the risk that the appointment itself might be questionable and could raise some very serious constitutional questions in the future regarding who we appoint. And I'd like to state why I believe that to be the case. It has always been our understanding in this body that judicial elections are conducted pursuant to a joint, special, and continuing order. And in point of fact, if you look at the chamber support staff, chamber protocol that all of us have received on numerous occasions in this body, and you turn to page 68 of that protocol, it discusses judicial elections and references judges. And it says, and I quote, the normal course of action during is for the House and the Senate to establish a joint special and continuing order for the election of certain judicial judgeships. It goes further to talk about it again as a joint special and continuing order. And a House joint resolution is introduced to set the joint special and continuing order. You might recall that because our rules require that if there is a special order be made under Rule 52 of our own rules, that it cannot be passed except by a vote of two-thirds of the members present. There's a ruling from the chair, and out of deference to the integrity of the body, I did not challenge the ruling of the chair, because that's the way we do things around here. But suffice it to say, we have a respectful difference of opinion on this rule. Rule 52 says that the regular order of business herein established shall not be changed, nor any special order be made, except by a vote of two-thirds of the members present. There is another provision of Rule 52 which speaks about a joint order with the Senate, but the language special is not used in that sentence. A joint order with the Senate would involve something like a procedural resolution that would require 50% vote. In the aftermath of the discussion the other day, we did a little research and we consulted Mason's Guide on Parliamentary Procedure. It's important because we look at that guide to guide us in how we conduct ourselves here.
The gentleman is aware we don't use Mason's here, we use Jefferson's manual.
We use both. And in Mason's, it talks about, under Section 263, General and Special Orders, and it talks about scheduling and controlling the flow of legislative business through the houses of the legislature. A special order is to expedite important business and set a definite time for its consideration, which gives the special order privilege, and therefore is the argument for why we do judges by special order. It is special. In our rules, Rule 49 sets the rules for the order of business in every session. Doesn't say anything about special orders. That's why we have a special order provision. It is special. It is outside the regular course of business. Under the rules, General Rules of Parliamentary Procedure, a special order should be subject to a two-thirds vote. And you can understand it. It is special. If somebody wanted to bring up a bill out of order that was not on the calendar, supplemental or otherwise, it would be special, and you'd have to have special dispensation. Otherwise, anybody could spring a bill on the body at any point in time. That's why you need the two-thirds majority. What we did the other day was we didn't pass that special order by two-thirds, and therefore it subjects the whole nominating process to some serious procedural problems that may turn up at some point with an enterprising lawyer who wants to take a shot at overturning a Supreme Court decision. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman is confusing joint order and special order. We do use special orders, which do require a two-thirds vote. And we use them at the beginning of the session when we set up the two times when we're going to elect judges. But there's nothing in that order, there's nothing in the Constitution that precludes us from bringing up judges at a different time. And it's clear, pursuant to Rule 51, that the order is a joint order and only requires a majority vote. I have made my ruling. If the gentleman cares to contest it, he certainly can. I understand his frustration, but we think using Jefferson's manual is our guide, that we're on firm ground with this. The gentleman from Manassas, Mr. Miller, speaking to
the resolution. Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, the resolution before us is a wonderful opportunity for each and every one of us here today. We have a candidate for the Virginia Supreme Court that is highly qualified, that has been serving on the Virginia Court of Appeals for the last few years, that's had the highest rating of every major bar association in the Commonwealth of Virginia. Mr. Speaker, my only disappointment in this resolution is it didn't happen 9 days ago. And the reason I say that it disappoints me that this didn't happen 9 days ago is because we still would have been in the month of February, which, as we learned in morning hour this session, February is Black History Month. And Mr. Speaker, this was a great opportunity. Wow. This is a great opportunity for the Commonwealth of Virginia to have more African-American Supreme Court justices than in any other state in the Union. Think about that. The Commonwealth of Virginia is making its own history with this appointment. This legislature can make the Commonwealth of Virginia the state with the most African Americans, the most Black Americans, on their Supreme Court. Getting the support from a body that where African Americans are the minority. That is an accomplishment. It's a piece of history. And I'm proud to be supporting this incredibly qualified candidate. And I hope that the body will agree with me and vote for this resolution. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Gentleman Fairfax, Mr. Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Speaking to the resolution.
Gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, you know, we do make history when we vote on a Supreme Court justice. We talk a lot about history in this House. Today, I want to go back almost 228 years, Mr. Speaker. It was on June 20th, 1788. A young member of this House of Delegates, who at that time was also serving as a delegate to the Virginia Convention, which was considering the U.S. Constitution, he stood in front of this body and he asked the following question. What is it that makes us trust our judges? And he answered for them, their independence in office and manner of appointment. Mr. Speaker, that was John Marshall, probably the greatest Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court in history. And he probably, more than anyone else in the history of the United States, cemented the rule of law, which we so revere in this country. Mr. Speaker and ladies and gentlemen of the House, I'm concerned today that we are about to ignore Chief Justice Marshall's wisdom from so long ago. You know, we are proud of our processes here in Virginia, Mr. Speaker, but this process went badly off the rails, badly off the rails. We should be beyond who should have called whom when and who didn't call whom when or who appeared at which press conference. I rise to express concern today, Mr. Speaker, that the way this seat has been considered by this General Assembly this year has the potential to leave a permanent stain on this institution, on the court, and on our Commonwealth. Everyone in this chamber, everyone in this Capitol building, everyone in this Capitol has seen the news articles and opinion pieces noting the 31 straight confirmations of gubernatorial nominations over the last 115 years. And as far as I can tell, no one, not a soul, has been able to find a single example in the history of our great Commonwealth of a sitting Supreme Court justice just being let go simply because the majority could. I'm a congenital optimist, Mr. Speaker. I know this General Assembly is made up of men and women of goodwill who've been and will continue to be great statesmen, who are here more out of love of the Commonwealth than on any particular party. And I urge us all to step back from the cliff we have put ourselves on and to not elect the candidate before us today, but rather to allow the circumstances which we face to continue and to allow the possibility that Justice Rausch would be able to resume her seat in due time. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman of Shenandoah, Mr. Gilbert.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Speaking to the resolution. The
gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm not sure to which matter the gentleman from Fairfax was speaking. I think it is a matter that is no longer before us. And the matter that is before us is the election of Judge Alston to the Supreme Court. That is the matter on the resolution, I think, that to which the gentleman should have been speaking. So speaking to the resolution, Mr. Speaker, we have before us a highly qualified and experienced candidate who is well-respected among his peers, among lawyers who appeared before him in the Juvenile and Domestic Relations Court where he once served, in the Circuit Court where he once served, and where he serves now as a highly respected jurist on the Court of Appeals. Mr. Speaker, when he appeared before us in the Courts Committee to elaborate on his judicial philosophy, which I might add, it was very clear that the judge thought it was important that jurists interpret and not write the law, which I think is something that we all in the legislature view as important, since that is our role in our branch of government to write the laws and have judges interpret them. The fact that the judge spoke so strongly about his role as a jurist in interpreting the law, I think was all very impressive to us. And he was just impressive generally. This is a man who has spent his life in public service, Mr. Speaker, in those three different levels of court. He was endorsed by all four of the major bar associations. There is not a dissenter to be found as to the qualifications of Judge Alston to rise to this important post. And so I think a no vote is a repudiation of every single bit of advice we can get about this man being right for this job, and everybody uniformly, except for the degree to which it imposes on what the governor believes was his prerogative, which it is not, to permanently put people on the Supreme Court. There is, except for that reason, there is no reason to vote against Judge Alston for this important post. So I would encourage the body to do that. He is our candidate. He is the man on the resolution. And again, Mr. Speaker, this is a man who has done nothing but impress all of those who work with him and who appear before him, and has done nothing but impress those of us who have interviewed him in this body. And so I highly commend him to the body to support this election. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman Chesapeake, Mr. Sproul.
Mr. Speaker, speaking to the resolution.
Speaking to the motion.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Mr. Speaker and members, I don't have my beads, Mr. Speaker. I've got to use these pennies here. I listened very carefully when the gentleman on the other side of the aisle used the word that for the first time Virginia can have more blacks. I keep using the word black and black. And I started having a flashback. I said to myself, born in 1946. I said, that's the oldest trick in the book that people try to use on black folks. We don't buy that stuff. These young black folks, you don't know it, because I'm real old. The question is not about the judge. He is qualified. That's not the question. He is highly qualified. The question is that you have a white female who is on the bench. that some disagree with the governor. So if you disagree with the governor, then blame the governor. But don't try to trick black folks by putting a black person up against black folks. That don't work this day and time. To my young black colleagues over here, is that listen to the whole matter. And truly, we have some smart black folks in this chamber and down the other side of the aisle. It's not a decision that the governor to us, because I would tell the governor in a minute when it comes to black folks if he's wrong, I'll tell him in a minute. So I'm saying that I wonder what would happen had that lady that the governor appoints, whether it was right or wrong, what happened if she was black? I wonder would y'all have challenged that then? I wonder about that. So I'm sitting here saying, well, Sproul.
Could I
Could
I advise the gentleman
to
be a little bit careful with his language?
I apologize, Mr. Speaker, I will.
The people on this side of the aisle.
I apologize, Mr. Speaker, I will. Yes, sir, I will. To all of you, the question is, look at why should we vote for anybody? Not because of a person is black or white. I'm just saying the gentleman is put up because the governor put the lady on the bench and someone don't like that, so they put up another challenge and try to use blacks as saying that we should vote for it. I'm asking y'all to stick with the governor. Thank you.
As many favor adoption of the resolution will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no.
No.
Resolution is agreed to. The gentleman from Richmond City, Mr. LaPasse, will inform the Senate of the nomination made by the House. The House will be at ease. To order. Members, please take your seats. Please take your seats. We're ready to vote. Those in favor of the Honorable Rossi D. Alston, Jr. to be Justice of the Supreme Court of Virginia for a term of 12 years, commencing March 3rd, 2016, will vote yes on the electronic voting machine. Clerk will close the roll.
Is
The Speaker appoints Delegates Alba, Lupassi, and Watts, the committee on the part of the House of Delegates, to count and report the vote of each House.
House of EDs. House will come to order. Members, please take your seats. General Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Speaker, I move that we suspend H.J.R. 424.
The General of Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox. General for Charlottesville, Mr. Toscano.
Yes, Mr. Speaker. Would the gentleman yield for a question?
I yield.
Would the gentleman tell us what H.J.R. 424 is?
That is the resolution that was in front of you that came over today dealing with elections. It says, resolved by the House of Delegates, Senate concurring, the General Assembly shall proceed to elect a member for the Supreme Court.
Speaker, will the gentleman yield for a question?
I yield.
Gentleman yield. Gentleman yields.
I'd ask the gentleman, haven't we just elected somebody out of this body to be on the Supreme Court?
The gentleman repeat the question.
I'd ask the gentleman, isn't it true that we just cast votes to elect someone out of this body to the Supreme Court of Virginia?
I would say the gentleman, we just did vote, but my understanding is the Senate has adjourned, and with that, obviously you cannot tally the votes at this point, so I think the proper thing under the resolution, the gentleman will look at 14 and 15, it says the joint order will be suspended by the presiding officer of either house at any time, but for no longer than 24 hours to receive the report of the joint committee. Obviously can't see the report at this point, so I think it makes perfect sense under that to suspend.
Parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Speaker.
You don't understand it.
Yes, Mr. Speaker, is the gentleman, doesn't the gentleman have to make the motion to suspend to a certain time and date?
No. I think the joint order says you have up 24 hours.
Will the gentleman yield for a question?
I yield.
I'd ask the gentleman, when does he intend to take up this issue again?
Well, I'd say the gentleman that under my reading of this, you have 24 hours, so any time during that time period.
Okay.
Then I would think at the end of the 24 hours, it's moot, basically.
Speaker, parliamentary inquiry?
Don't understand it.
My understanding to be correct, at least on this one, it does require a majority vote alone. To suspend the rule.
Majority vote, yes.
Not a supermajority. Is that right?
Not unless you want it.
I want it, but I know it can't get it under this rule. At least I agree on that one with you. Thank you.
Shall the motion be agreed to? Many in favor of that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no.
No.
Motion is agreed to.
Back in the morning.
Back in the morning.
Yeah, we're back in the morning hour. Clerk, have any announcements or communications?
Speaker, today's meeting schedule, the only meeting this afternoon is the Courts of Justice, House Courts of Justice Committee will meet immediately upon adjournment of the House downstairs in House Room 1 here in the Capitol to certify judges for tomorrow's consideration. House Courts, certification of judges immediately upon adjournment downstairs in House Room 1. That's the only legislative meeting for this afternoon. Looking ahead to tomorrow morning, Wednesday, March 9th, the several caucus meetings to begin the day. The Arts Caucus will meet at 8 o'clock in 5th Floor West Conference Room. Over in the GAB, the Military and Veterans Caucus will meet also at 8 o'clock. They'll be in 4th Floor West Conference Room. Also tomorrow morning at 8, the Women's Healthcare Caucus. They will be meeting in the 3rd Floor East Senate Conference Room. Finally, the Democratic Caucus will meet at 9:30. Tomorrow in House Room 2, downstairs in the Capitol, the Republican Caucus will meet at 9:15 downstairs in House Room 1 here in the Capitol. That completes announcements. I have. I'm sorry, Mr. Speaker.
General Fairfax, Mr. Hugo.
Mr. Speaker, I believe Republicans would have a caucus downstairs right after we recess.
Well, that's what I was thinking, too, but I understand courts is meeting downstairs immediately upon adjournment. Perhaps you guys can meet a half hour after adjournment.
So the House Republican Caucus is going to meet immediately upon the adjournment downstairs today, House Room 1. Courts of Justice Committee will meet a half hour after adjournment of the House down in House Room 1.
Mr. Speaker.
Gentlewoman from Fairfax, Ms. Corey.
Thank you. I rise for an announcement.
Okay. Gentlewoman has the floor.
Okay. The Women's Health Care Caucus is not going to meet tomorrow. Oh, well, you can... Never mind.
I was a little concerned because I think it conflicts with the Art Caucus. And what do you do?
Mr. Speaker, I'd also request Senate Joint Resolution 210. There's a co-patron sign-on sheet that's floating around the chamber somewhere, if you would be so kind, if you have it, to return it to Delegate Taylor. SJ210, co-patron sign-on sheet.
The gentleman, Colonial Heights, Fairfax, Mr. Hugo.
Mr. Speaker, I just want to remind our members, right afterwards, there is a caucus. It's important everybody attend.
Thank you. General Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Mr. Speaker, I move that when the House adjourned today, adjourn to reconvene tomorrow at 10 a.m.
The General from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox, moves when the House adjourned today, adjourn to reconvene tomorrow at 10 a.m. As many as favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. That motion is agreed to. The General from Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox.
Mr. Speaker, I move the House to now adjourn.
General Colonial Heights, Mr. Cox, moves the House to now adjourn. As many as favor that motion will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. That motion is agreed to. The House stands adjourned until 10 a.m. tomorrow. The House will come to order. The House will be at ease.